Good morning. This is Monday, February 7th in the year 2000. Here in Natick, Massachusetts, this is part of the Morse Institute Library Continuing Veterans Oral History Project. This morning, we are privileged to have with us Albert Mickey Folkhard. Good morning to you, sir.
Good morning.
Nice to have you with us.
Thank you.
Do you mind if I ask you your age?
I am 85.
85.
Yes.
You're in good shape.
No, I'm not.
Well, you look like you're in good shape. What is your address, Albert? Or may I call you Mickey during this?
Please call me Mickey.
Thank you. What is your address?
Wellesley.
And your current marital status?
Married.
Do you have children?
52 or 53 years, I forget which.
Really?
I have two children, both girls.
And do you have grandchildren?
Yes, one grandchild. One of my daughters, the youngest one, was born deaf. She's doing very well.
I'm pleased to hear that. Where were you born?
I was born in Woolwich, England, downriver from London, the next town to Greenwich. And Woolwich was famous for its armament industry, which was the national armory for the manufacture of all heavy shells for France.
Mm-hmm. Were you raised there?
What's that?
Were you raised in that town?
Well, up to 4.5 years of age. That was 1919, as I told you,
mm-hmm.
when we came to America. It was a plot plan by my father and mother. My sister had been wounded rather badly as a kid, an infant, in a Zeppelin raid on London. And it ripped up a whole leg and damaged part of her interiors, I guess. And we came to this country. My father wanted to come to America. England was on the down with a lot, tragic loss of life all around and whatnot, broken homes and everything else. And my mother, of course, her mother and her sister and brothers had all come from Ireland to America. They were in Charlestown on Monument Avenue, which is the entrance to the monument.
Mm-hmm. Before this tape started, you were kind enough to share with us the fact that your father and your whole family, as a matter of fact, had a very extensive military background during World War I.
Yes.
Your father served in India. He served in Kenya, if I'm correct.
Yes, that's right.
And he was part of the Khyber Rifles, yes. Is that correct?
That was the Northwest Frontier. And my
yes.
brother, Timothy, I forgot to mention, my first brother was born in Ireland in Cork. My second brother was born on the Northwest Frontier in India. Oh, he had a nickname, of course, the Indian. My sister and I were born in London.
In London?
Yeah.
And you came to the States in 1919.
19.
And where did you first come to? Where did the family first come to?
We came to Charlestown. My mother's sister and my mother's father and mother were living in a house on Monument Avenue in Charlestown.
Mm-hmm.
And we stayed with them for about 3 weeks, I guess. And then my mother bought a house up the street, 53 Monument Avenue. It was the last brick house on the right going up towards the monument.
This is the Bunker Hill Monument.
Bunker Hill
correct?
Monument.
Yeah.
And my father joined us having been finally passed out of the army because his wounds had now all been cured. And he arrived in November 1920.
So
the
had
family
you come
was
over
together
here?
Again.
Had you come over here prior to your father coming over? He
oh,
came
yes,
over
the
a year
before.
Later. I see.
The year before. He came over in 20 and we came over in 1919.
Okay. At what point did you come to Wellesley or this area?
Oh, I came to Wellesley in 1947 when we bought a little house on College Road, which mm-hmm. was then a dirt road. And I guess we paid $13,000 for it.
That's expensive in those days.
$500 down the GI mortgage and a 12-5 mortgage at 4%. And the monthly payment was $55.55 every month, which included the taxes and the payment.
Can you imagine what this is going to sound like to historians in about 50 years? Where was your schooling principally, Mickey?
My schooling started out in Charlestown in St. Mary's Grammar School. I was there for 4 years. And I'm trying to think of Sister Rose Gabriel was our teacher. And I found out after the war that she was in Bethany up in Framingham and along in years, and I used to go and visit her with Emma. She finally died there. That was then, at the end of the fourth year there, I transferred over to the Jesuit school in the North End, St. Mary's, run by the Sisters of Notre Dame. And I was there for 4 more years. And then from there, I went to Boston College High School.
I understand. And you got there, you got a scholarship, is that correct?
Yeah, for Boston College and Boston College High. Mm-hmm. But I graduated in 1933 from Boston College High School. And in 1937 from Boston College.
And what were your interests in school? What did you major in?
Well, in those days at Boston College, you majored in, you didn't major in anything really apart from philosophy, but you had a heavy dose of science, chemistry and physics, 2 years of math, 2 years of French, 2 years, 4 years of English, 2 years of oratory, and I've left some things out there. But it was pretty much predicted. And in senior year, there was a choice of one elective from a large pot called two. So I took both of them. I took one in art history, and the other one, of course, in English, which was a principal concern of mine.
And you graduated in 37?
Graduated in 37.
Now, I have here that you have advanced degrees or interest in Latin and Greek. Is that correct?
Yeah. Well, I forgot that. That was a heavy dose in Boston College. I had 3 years of Latin and 3 years of Greek. The art day was a very busy one, I'll tell you that.
I think we can assume that you were a very well-educated man when you came out of college.
Yeah, and I had learned German on the side, so I had German and French. And Greek, I could speak Greek, ancient Greek, but modern Greek is pretty close to it.
Did you go on toward advanced degrees?
This is when where I went to Harvard.
Okay.
In 1938, I guess it was, or 37, I forget which. You know, the first semester.
And what were your majors there?
My major there was literature and archaeology.
You were going to?
I was going to move to archaeology ultimately.
That's a very interesting field.
Yeah.
We're up to about 1938, 39, something like that.
Yeah.
And war breaks out in Europe.
Yep.
Did you feel that you might sometime become involved in that?
As a matter of fact, I tried to join the British Army in September of 1943. I went to the consulate office. What a mistake that was. I was really hot under the collar to go.
Was that 43, Mickey?
Not 43, 39. I was hot under the collar to go. And I was cut off, of course, because my father was a pensioner, and he had to go every 3 months for his pension to the consulate office in Boston, wherever it was. And of course, I got knocked down, so I waited. And the following March, I went to, this is 1940, March 1940. I went to the recruiting office, which was next to the public library in the square there, Copley Square. And it was a very narrow building that widened up on the corner of Huntington Avenue and I guess, what street is that crossing?
That's Dartmouth Street.
Dartmouth Street, on the corner, very narrow building up on the fourth floor. And that's where I gave them all my information on what I...
That's now the Marriott Hotel. That's now the Marriott Hotel, if you...
Oh, that's on the other side.
Well, okay.
It's on the left-hand side of Huntington Avenue coming out this way. I mean, this thing was right.
So you were anxious to get into the war.
And yeah, I was really hot under the collar, I guess.
And the United States has not yet entered the war.
That's right.
And you were still at Harvard at this time.
Yes.
What was your urge to get into the war, Mickey?
I was the surviving son, in a way, since my two brothers were older, and one of them was in California working on submarines, and the other had been injured along with my sister with a bad heart in the Zeppelin raid on London. They were trying to hit the Woolwich Arsenal, as a matter of fact. And there was no strategic tactical bombing. They were loading 50-pound bombs out of the... Two guys would lift it up and throw it over the side of the little bucket basket on the Zeppelins. Now, where was I?
You were in May of 1940. You have enlisted. Is that correct?
No, it was March 12th. I said that earlier. I had made all preliminaries in March 1930, you know, information and all this jazz. And I had tried to put my name down, so to speak, that I would come in when I could or when I'd be able to. And I wanted to join the 1st Division. The 1st Division was down in Louisiana on maneuvers. And of course, the 7th Artillery was, of course.
Why that particular division?
Because an old boyfriend of my Aunt Moll, Jimmy McCann, was a corporal in the 7th Field Artillery in France in World War I. I got a lot of information from it.
I bet you did.
As a matter of fact, after the war, he was sent to Russia for some unknown reason. I've never been able to put that piece together. Some American troops went to Russia, and they were from France, so to speak. And what he came home with that he finally gave to me was a fur hat, a Russian fur hat that was issued to the troops.
That's a good keepsake to have.
Oh, it fell apart finally.
Just about a couple of months later now, the United States enters the war. What was your status at that time?
Well, I was with the 7th Field Artillery from when I joined it at Fort Devon until, I guess it was August.
Of what year?
They had promoted me to private. This is 1942. They had promoted me to private. And Coburn, Lieutenant Colonel Coburn, who turned out to be a great friend of mine later for what he did for me, he was commander of the battalion. And he nailed me for school at
Devon's?
No, not at Devon's, at Oklahoma Artillery School. Oh, what's it called? It's 90 Day Wonders,
Fort
I guess.
Fort Sill?
Huh?
It was at Fort Sill?
Fort Sill.
Did family or friends join the military when you did?
No.
Or did you go in by yourself?
Alone. Yeah.
And you started out at Fort Devon's in Massachusetts?
Yeah.
And from there...
To artillery school.
Yeah.
An artillery school, and I was commissioned, ended on December 20th, but the previous December 1st, 7th, was Pearl Harbor. And there was a little bit of a hurried-up call to get this thing over with and get people going out. So those of us who graduated, we were the larger number of the group who started.
Would you tell us about your training there?
Yeah, close order drills, so to speak. And particularly imitating officers who would give orders to the recruits who were practicing, all right?
What about artillery training?
Oh, a lot of classes.
Tell us specifically what you did there.
Yeah, a lot of them were classes relating to artillery, the history of artillery, particularly American artillery in the Civil War, and then in the other war, but 1898, the
Spanish-American War,
yeah.
Yes.
And then the development, or the attempted development, of a 4.5 howitzer, or gun, and it proved a disaster. And I mention this because the guns that were used for training at Fort Sill were not 105 howitzers. They were 4.5 guns that oftentimes blew apart.
Mm.
Yeah. They were duds. And those were the armament that the American Army had. Not to mention the steel helmets of the British style.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what was. I was awarded one of those.
Earlier on, before we started that, you said you began as a yard bird. I was the
lowest of the low.
That's lower than a private, isn't it?
Oh, it's below a private. My God, privates would look down at you. And of course, I got razzed to beat hell. And
what rank were you then at Fort Sill?
At Fort Sill, I was no rank, a corporal, so to speak. They promoted me a corporal on the day before I left by train for Fort Sill. Right?
And how long were you at Fort Sill, Mickey?
90 days, 90-day wonders, they would call.
When you came out of that, were you a second lieutenant?
I was a second lieutenant, yeah. Green, very green.
And where did you go from there?
From there, I came home to Boston. And for Christmas, of course. And I said goodbye on Christmas. Little Christmas, I guess it was, January 6th, to my mother and father, and to my wife, to be.
That was the Christmas of 42?
Christmas of 41. No, Christmas 42, where was I? That's in California, I think.
Okay, well,
I went from Fort Bragg. My orders were to go to Fort Bragg on such and such a day, but home for Christmas. That's where I spent. Then I had to pick up and go to my first assignment, so to speak, which was Fort Bragg. That was the headquarters now of the armored force that was in its infancy.
Okay.
All right.
So you're down in North Carolina, is that correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. And what did you do there?
We did a lot of examining and trying out this thing and that thing in tanks. But what the hell were the tanks? Excuse me. But they were Stuarts, those tiny little tanks that were mounting a 37-inch gun. That was their weaponry. And moreover, the big ones, the M3s, as they were called, those disastrous fiascos that the Germans shot up at Kasserine Pass. They were monsters. The heavy armor on it was a 75-barrel short rifle on the right-hand side of the tank in a turret, right? Now, you could fire to the right with that gun. And don't forget, it was a short barrel 75, which wasn't very good. If you wanted to fire to the left, you had to maneuver the tank around. And those were the tanks of the 1st Armored Division that fought in North Africa. And they were butchered.
Are you, I must...
Oh, wait a minute. Now, from there, the call was, we go to California to a new army camp that's in the process of being developed but is near the perfection stage. And this was Lompoc, California, about 45 miles up from Santa Barbara. And it was called Camp Cook. Camp Cook was to be the home now of the embryonic 5th Armored Division. And the 5th Armored Division consisted principally of cadres. And I was a cadre for the 95th Armored Field Artillery Battalion. We had no guns. We had two French 75 howitzers from World War I as the heavy armament on that campus. And of course, the kids who were coming in, and they were mostly kids, were recruits under the first draft. They were coming in and they were training on knowing the basic parts, at least, of a gun, you know. And they weren't allowed to fire them, of course. There was no firing range there. But ultimately, what was coming in were single copies of the M4 tank, which was the Sheridan, what's the name of it?
Sherman.
Sherman. That was the mainstay of the American armored forces in World War II.
Mickey, for clarification for other people looking at this at some other time, was there an admixture between the artillery and tank groups, or had you moved further over into being solely in tanks?
They were combined only in the way of commands. There were three commands in an armored division, A, B, and C. A, I forget his name, a colonel, a great friend of the man from Pride's Crossing. I can't think of names. You know whom I mean. The famous tank commander in World War II.
Patton?
Patton. God, I'm looking right at the book that I have at home. He was a great friend of Patton's. They were at maneuvers together. He had combat command, CCA. CCB, no, he didn't have it. He had CCB. CCA was commanded by a character called, he was a brigadier general anyway, Dolinette or something like that. It was a French name. And at the top of the heap in this beginning formation, and you know, there weren't many kids in, and there wasn't any equipment to speak of, but there was a general who was trying to put it together. It was his responsibility. And this was Ward. What a funny first name. He's a major general of long standing. Oh, what was that funny first name he had? He was putting together, so to speak, through his aides and whatnot, the formation of this division.
But you are a specific...
Alonzo Ward was his name.
You are now working in tanks, is that correct?
No, I was working in artillery.
You're still on the artillery
and the
side.
Tanks. But you see, a combat command produced the melding of the tanks and the artillery.
Okay.
There were three components. There was a battalion of guns. There was a battalion of infantry, and there was a battalion of tanks. And they were following the German pattern in a way that hadn't been followed, of bringing the three together as supporting each other, right? And not letting the infantry out there supported by one tank, all right?
Mm-hmm.
Combined arms, so to speak.
So you were training in California.
Yeah.
And how long were you at that particular base?
Well, I was trying to think today. I got... The colonel, McNair, placed my name for, I don't think he liked me anyway, but he placed my name on a list to send somewhere as a member of a group, there would be many groups of the same kind, being sent to North Africa to instruct tank gunners and artillery gunners with the new equipment that was coming in. Now, backing this up a little bit, the British Eighth Army had retreated to, in a near disastrous way, from way in their the city that the Germans had captured on the coast.
Tobruk.
Tobruk. Drove the British right back to the prepared position at El Alamein, which was over the dividing line between Libya and Egypt. What Roosevelt evidently had promised Churchill, and Churchill probably had requested it in desperation, because the Eighth Army had spiked its guns. They were all trucked around artillery, the old 25-pounders, much like a 105. They had spiked all their guns on the retreat from way up, chased by Rommel, now reinforced. I think he had the 90th Light Mountain Division, a German division, the 21st Armored Division, the Panzer Division, and the 10th. That was his armament, along with some Italian troops, and he drove them back. And they spiked their guns, they destroyed what tanks they had, and the tanks weren't very good. And they had nothing, therefore, when they got back, not much by way of good equipment. So what Roosevelt promised them was what the American foundries were about to produce in great numbers, but they were coming off in ones and twos, I suppose. Chrysler and General Motors and Packard were two of the big manufacturers, if I remember rightly, of 105 howitzers, truck drawn. That was for the artillery, great weapon. And then Mark IV tanks, Shermans, and particularly now, the new weapon, which was the tank gun. And this was an artillery weapon. It was a tank stripped down of its turret, but with armor, mounting a 105 howitzer, all right?
Can you tell us the difference between the tanks you're describing now and those that were destroyed at the Kasserine Pass?
The tanks that were destroyed at the Kasserine Pass were the old models, mm-hmm. with a side gun.
Yeah,
and they were slow, lumbering things, and they offered very little by way of armor protection and the turret, and it was a trap, really. And Rommel caught them, magnificently, and chewed them up. And he also isolated the 7th Field Artillery, by the way, and captured a number of their guns. Not Rommel, but his troops, of course.
So these new tanks that the president had promised were
they
far
were the Shermans,
superior.
Shermans, yeah. And he vowed to re-equip the British Eighth Army after Churchill's plea. And the purpose of this group that I was talking about, and there were 15 of the groups ultimately that went, they had knock-ups, I suppose, and papers, in paper, and parts and parcel of the new kinds of devices that they were going to mount on the 109s for accuracy and whatnot and all this, and things of that sort. And the structure of the frame that would carry the 105 howitzer, and it wasn't much different from the British general structure, but it was a replacement weapon that was a very good one.
You said your name was submitted to be part of a group that might be sent to North Africa.
Yeah, there were five or six or seven of us, and we were, I was a first lieutenant then. Five or six of us, one from the 95th, and one from another battalion. Yeah, there were two from one from the 5th Armored Division, and then there were maybe six or eight, I forget which, from other divisions that were being formed all over the country.
And were you sent there with this group?
Yeah. Yeah.
Where were you sent? Where did you go?
Well, I remember going by train to Eglin Field, and I'd never heard of Eglin Field before. And from there, one group of us, that was maybe the second or third group, it flew to someplace in Brazil. I forget the name of the area. It was taken over by the British with the arrangement with the Brazils. It was an airfield, I suppose, and whatnot. And we flew to Africa on a B-24, if I'm not mistaken. Wasn't a very comfortable plane. Seats were kind of makeshift, but that was all right. And so our job was...
Where did you land in Africa?
We landed at two places in Africa. Oh, where the hell was it? What was the British colony?
Well, were you on your way to confront Rommel? Is that?
No. We were crossing below the Sahara, and we came up into Egypt.
So possibly you landed at Kenya or worked your way up from there?
Ah, you're right.
Okay.
Yeah, we went to Kenya and then up.
Okay, so you're in Egypt now. And about what is the date now that you're in Egypt?
It's the summertime.
The middle of 43, would this be?
No, this was 42.
And what did you do in Egypt?
I'm trying to think. It was July, as a matter of fact, because a very significant thing happened to me. It was July. What you did was instruct the chief of sections for the various battalions of artillery in the new devices that were, as I mentioned earlier, the new devices by way of mechanical gearing and what else. You traverse a gun, and I'm trying to think of the words, and I can't, that's all. And it should be second nature to me. You traverse the gun with cranks, you know, back and forth, but these were hydraulic now. Well, you didn't have to break your arm cranking them back.
Yes.
That was one part of it. Another part was the type of shell that the gun would fire. It was a 105 howitzer shell. Well, a 105 howitzer is about the equivalent of a 4-inch gun, right? Okay. The 25-pounder that the British fired was equivalent to the 105 howitzer, so to speak. And the, yeah, that was right. The German armament, at this time in North Africa was the German 88, both long-barreled and short-barreled, which were equivalent to a French 75. Now, I'm talking about measurements now, right? But of course they had much higher speed, velocity and whatnot. In any event, that's what we did for a couple of weeks, you know. Chat with the various people, and little schools were held.
Were you in Cairo, Mickey, or where were you specifically?
Oh, I had a ride into Cairo, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, then I was able, thanks to talk about accidents that happen in war. My godfather was my father's best friend in the British Army. Right? After the war, which he survived, he took his family and they went down to Somerset in England, which is the southwest of England. He was my godfather. And his wife had a son or he did, my age. Okay. Now, when I went to England with my mother in 1930, we went, of course, to the Bowermans and to visit them. And the son and I struck up a lovely friendship. We went bicycling together, if I remember. And we became pen pals. So, communicated with him regularly, about once every 3 months, across the water and all. I didn't know he was in the army, but he did join the army, following his father, I suppose. And whom do I bump into in the streets of Cairo? My pen pal.
That's a small world. I must ask you, while you were there, did you ever sit on the balcony at Shepherd's Hotel?
No.
That's, they say that if you sat there long enough, you'd see anybody in the world going by.
I know. Shepherd's Hotel was a hangout for British officers.
Yeah, but you ran into him anyway.
Yeah.
This is now July.
And wait a minute. From an old teacher at Harvard and one at BC who taught me a lot about Egyptian architecture and whatnot, and one of them, Doc Bowen, who taught history through architecture at BC in my senior year, that extra course I told you I took along with the English course, mm-hmm. He enthralled me with his great stories about Abu Simbel and how he had spent overnight in that great cavern cut into the hill in order to see the magnificent murals on the walls and the statues that were absolutely untouched. They had all been cleaned out by Napoleon troops, all the sand that had filled up. This was a great cathedral, so to speak, Abu Simbel. You may have read some years ago how they moved that great thing carved into the red stone rock on the west bank of the Nile.
They lifted the whole thing because of the flooding of Lake Nasser.
Yeah.
Yes.
So that was my great desire, and I mentioned it to him. And he had been in Egypt since late 1939. They had reinforced the British garrison there, of course, not knowing what the Germans were going to do. And he hadn't been home at all, and he hadn't had much leave. So I said, what could you arrange for a little trip for us? He said, I can take some leave, too, down the river. So up the river, I should say.
That's correct. It runs to the north.
We went up in a de Havilland, which was a cut above a Piper Cub, right? If you got a good wind, it'll blow you over. And we went down to Abu Simbel, and I stayed overnight there, and I'll never forget it.
Oh, that's a very memorable thing to do.
There's only a very short period of time in the season when the sun coming over the east bank of the Nile came right in through those narrow slit doors, very high, and there were four of them, if I remember rightly, and just illuminates the inside of that great bit of architecture. I'll never forget that as long as I live. Okay.
Mickey, what did you do?
So we came back from Egypt and rejoined the 5th Armored.
Rejoined it where?
At Lompoc.
We okay, went over there so you went long. Back to California again, is that
yeah,
correct?
Yeah, I went back by train to California.
And what did you do there the second time?
A friend of mine, Auer, who was a first lieutenant like me, was a mathematician. And he was inveigled into seeing what he could do by way of measuring out a rifle range in one of the canyons. And the canyons around Lompoc are very interesting things. Sometimes they fill up with water when they have a storm, but they haven't had many storms lately, have they? And he took me out a couple of times while he did his measurements, but it never worked out, but spent a lot of time on that. And then the guns were coming in. What I forgot to tell you, before I went to Egypt, in May, I guess it was, a Japanese submarine had surfaced between Lompoc and Santa Barbara and lobbed in some shells from its deck gun into the famous Elwood oil fields.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, all hell broke loose. There wasn't any kind of weaponry if they landed on the West Coast, that area, to do anything. So there was great panic. And in the meanwhile, I think the Japanese got those balloon bombs, remember?
Yes, I do.
They floated them up into Washington and Oregon.
I think that
was a
submarine fired the first hostile shots at the United States that it had ever received.
Right. That was the Elwood oil fields.
Yeah.
And I think they shot up two rounds. And you know what happened 2 days later? Stands were set up all along that highway, and they were selling fragments of shells from the Japanese guns. Oh, my God. Pieces of steel.
Do you feel that the United States Army prepared you as you went along in your training for what you might face in the future? Did you know, perhaps, that you were going to go to Europe eventually?
I chose to go to Europe. The 5th Armored Division, full-blown now, was taken over. We went over by train, of course. That was the principal means of movement, to Tennessee and Kentucky for maneuvers, right? And I think there were at least two armored divisions, of which the 5th was one, and maybe a couple of armored brigades, which was a new wrinkle coming in, for war games, right?
Is this the end of 1942, Mickey?
No, yeah. No, this is moving now into 90.
You were in Cairo in July of 42, so from what you've just said, we're getting toward the end of 1942, I gather.
No, I guess 42 ran out in Lompoc. Yes, of course. That, it took that time to get the division equipped and the full number of recruits in all the three infantry battalions and the tanks and the artillery and the engineers and so much more.
After the maneuvers, where did you go from there?
The maneuvers were, I wish I could fix the date for you, but I can't, of when the maneuvers were, and I think they ran over a bit into...
This would be about January of 43. Yeah. So where did you go from there?
I was a little bit later than January, I guess, when the maneuvers occurred. Yeah, I guess it was. Because I put in a request for change that caused the battalion commander, once again, to blackball me. He put me into the S1 division of the division, S1, S2, S3, S4, S1. And the guy who was the officer commanding, Lieutenant Colonel, was a lawyer from Wellesley, as a matter of fact. His name was Marx. And I got around that one because I put in a very strong request, thanks to a friend whom I mentioned earlier, who was working in Washington at the time, and who was on the process of probably making Lieutenant General, and that was Coburn. And I said, I want to be shifted to the 1st Infantry Division. And it finally worked out, and I had a rough time of it. And I arrived in North Africa, after the North African thing was over. I arrived in Tunis, I guess it was, with a whole group of young replacements for the infantry battalions that had had a rough time of it, of course. And they were preparing now to begin the invasion of Sicily, I guess. And that's how I got to Sicily. So I've been a roving character.
Where did you sail from to go to Sicily?
New York, if I'm not mistaken.
And where did you go, directly to Sicily, or land in Italy somewhere, or North Africa?
Oh, no, not Italy, my God. Oh, not Bizerta, but one of the, oh, where the French Navy was holed up.
And Oran?
Destroyed. No, beyond Oran, to the west of Oran. That's where...
Okay. Yeah.
And the divisions were re-equipping themselves, and they were resting up for the attack on Gela. And I was back with, thank God, the Big Red One.
You were big Red One, yeah.
But more than that, it was the 7th Field Artillery.
All right, what was your objective as you sailed towards Sicily? Where were you headed?
I had no objective. I knew where we were going in. We were going into Iran. And the word was around that a famous division, so to speak, of the German army, a special division, the Hermann Göring division, was loose in Sicily. Well, that turned out to be true, but it wasn't the hard punch that was supposed to be. The commander split it into two areas, two sections, so to speak, to attack the Americans when they landed, and they did a little bit of damage, but not much. And I, of course, was a forward observer when going in for the landing.
What was your rank by now, Mickey?
My rank was captain. Now, the interesting thing is that I'm at sea, waiting to go down over those goddamned rope ladders. I'll never forget those, pardon the language. I almost killed myself once on those. All I could think of was knowing Greek literature, knowing Greek drama inside out, and knowing that the old man himself was the founder of Greek drama, who had fought at either Salamis, and that was a ship fight, or Marathon, an old soldier, who had come to Gela and died there as an old man.
Aeschylus.
I couldn't get over it. God, I cried that night, honest to the Lord. And the beach was no great shakes. It was a nice flat beach, that I remember. There wasn't too much of a fight. 45th Division came in one part of us. There were a lot of units landing. They massed them. Oran was only, not Oran, but Gela was only one part of it. But
where did you go from the beachhead? Which direction did you go in?
What do you mean?
The army split. One went up the west coast, one went up the east coast. Which way did you go?
The west went straight ahead into Jela, which was to the east.
Yes.
The division that hit the beach at on the right-hand side, I mean on the left-hand side, was the 45th Division. And they had a road march almost all the way, except for some little firefights, to Palermo. And they were the first troops into Palermo. Now, Patton was in charge on that operation.
He was racing Montgomery up the other coast, is
yes.
that correct?
Yeah. And Montgomery had the tougher fight, I think, because the Germans, many of them were retreating, and they were fighting a hell of a rearguard action as Montgomery was pouring them in.
Mickey, were you yourself at this time in direct combat?
Was I?
Yes.
Yeah.
Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Direct combat means, from my point of view at that time, trying to spot shells as they were exploding where they should have exploded. Seeing the enemy, but terrified. The noise of munitions going off, the noise of pain. The noise of pain was terrible. I've encountered that a lot ever since.
Were you yourself wounded?
Not there. No, I was wounded after Normandy, about 10 or 12 days after Normandy.
How long were you in Sicily then?
I was in Sicily for about 9 or 10 days, I guess.
Mm-hmm. And where did you go from Sicily?
In Sicily, we went by boat to, I think, the north of England, I'm not sure. Some of them went to the north of Ireland and others to the north of England, and this was for preparation, of course, for D-Day.
Yeah.
And on the approach to the embarkation ports, the unit I was with, I was to be a forward observer again, and that's how I got on the beach. And the irony of that thing was that some wise guy thought that the great thing to do would be to mount 105 howitzers on assault craft and then have them fire as they were coming in. And of course, they were all sunk. Direct hits by German fire. I don't think any of them hit the beach.
Can you back up just a minute
yeah.
here? You're in England. You've been in Sicily, you've been in combat.
Yeah.
Can you tell us about getting ready to go overseas to attack the French coast? The greatest invasion in history. Yeah. Where were you getting ready for that?
I was in the north of England. And the preparation was constant preparation by way of equipment, constant preparation of staying in great physical stamina, which after all, if you're floating around in the ocean in a large barge, so to speak, you don't get much chance to do your exercises. And a lot of meetings with chaplains and whatnot, and battalion commanders and company commanders. The point being that you get to know, if it's a company or a platoon more likely, you get to know each other as buddies and friends. And there's a coherence between this, but there's a whole series of attachments that they are brothers and we're fighting together. And after all, that's what carried the assault on Normandy through.
As a forward observer, what kind of special training did you undertake?
Nothing special except on artillery ranges. Your job was to call for fire on occasion and then start to move it, all right? And if you had a good look at it, you could issue commands back, which you couldn't, of course, at Normandy. And I forget the terms, but they were technical terms, about moving the sighting on the gun a little to the left, a foot. Oh, God, you can see what a hole in my head has done to me. Honest to God, it's ridiculous.
I think you're doing very well, and I'd like to ask you to remember sailing across the channel. What did you think about that?
I was very tense. I said a lot of prayers, I'll tell you that. I continued to talk with the guys around me, many of them I knew, of course, talking about different things rather than, you know, we're going in and we're going to get the hell kicked out of us and all this jazz. That didn't go. You were trying to convince everyone and convince yourself that, look, we're young, we're not going to die. We're going to beat the hell out of those bastards. That was, I'll never forget the airborne cry. You know what it was? It was in Latin. Ne caberundum illegitimis.
Don't let the bastards get you down.
Exactly. And as I...
So your education finally paid off. That must have been, what time of day did you get on the beach, and what beach did you land on?
I landed on Easy Red with E Company of the 16th Infantry. That was the bloody beach.
About what time?
6:31.
So you were there right at the beginning.
And a character called Kappa was in the next group, I think, if I'm not mistaken, those famous pictures he threw.
Mm-hmm.
And of course he took many pictures and he was flitting around with no care to his own person. Everyone else, you know, thinking, what the hell, are we going to get shot at now or die or something? He's taking pictures. And then one of the assault landing craft came in and they were all able to back out, most of them that weren't blown up. And he grabbed one of those to go out to get to London to develop his film and send it back to the USA. Oh, what a character he was. I didn't know him very well. But
what were you?
He was killed. He was killed at Fort Dien something. In near Hanoi, where the French
Dien Bien Phu.
Dien Bien Phu.
Yeah,
that's where he got killed.
Much later.
Yeah.
What was your immediate objective when you went ashore? What were you to do?
Well, one of the plans was that you make your way to a couple of so-called notches. But the notches weren't there. What the hell do they call them? I forget. They were like gaps in the sand. The beach that the big red we hit. There was a hell of a casemate, not too far away. There were in other areas. The other combat team from another division that was on the north side, or the I guess it was the west side of Omaha. West side? No. The west side, that's right. They got really pulverized when they hit the beach. It was a combat team out of some of the companies out of the 118th, 116th, 118th combat team of another division. I think it may have been the 4th Division. Big Red One was at the other end and was pretty bloody.
Were you at this time in charge of a platoon size organization?
I had to take charge, as
you were
a matter of fact.
Platoon commander, you know, then?
No, I wasn't. I was a platoon commander in the sense that I had to take over. The platoon commander was killed. There'll never be noise like that again. It was terrifying.
You have told us today that you are hard of hearing. Would you attribute this to your wartime service?
I don't know. About 15 days after we got out of Normandy and the division was moving, recruits and all had come in and all, but we were still fighting. I was in a tank. We weren't too far out from Normandy. We were moving kind of south. I was called to get a line on an object that was camouflaged and see what could be done. I got up in a tank, and I was standing on the little seat in the tank, which is about 10 inches below the turret of the tank. And I was, you know, exposed with a pair of binoculars, trying to zero in on that tank. And I was about to shout, fire, I guess, when the tank fired. It was a German tank with an armor-piercing shell. Now, I didn't know that until 15 or 20 days later when I woke up. It blew the tank, made mincemeat of the five guys below, blew all the ammunition, which caused me to be dumped out of the tank, since, you know, that was the air pocket out. And I landed evidently on my head and right shoulder and right hip. I don't know how they did that, but that's what they told me later. And I guess I got creased on the head where this hole is, which Nirmal had to open wide to for the last bleed, which is only a month, year and a half ago.
Say that again, Mickey, excuse me. I'm not quite sure what you said. You had surgery a year and a half ago?
Yeah.
As a result of the wound you got that day?
No. I said he had to work on the hole in my head then.
I see. Okay.
No, that happened with my car.
Okay. That's different.
Taking groceries out of the door after having a hip replacement and thinking I was Atlas, you know.
Right.
The rear door in the wind.
You wound up?
Hit me right on the head here when I had both hands loaded with two bags of groceries from Stop and Shop. And oh God, did it hurt. I didn't know what happened. But it hit all the sore spot that I landed on and got blocked out on, as a matter of fact, in Normandy. No, in any event, I came to, and when I came to, I guess I was unconscious for maybe 8 or 9 days. I didn't know where the hell I was. I didn't know whether I was in England or Ireland or Germany.
Where were you?
I was behind the lines in a field hospital. I had no blood on me, right? None whatsoever. And a bruise on my head, and what it was a cracked skull. And there was a little hole, something had penetrated it. I was in a coma for a number of days. I awakened from the coma, and I was perfectly all right. Next thing I know, I'm in a rebel depot, a replacement depot. That was my chance to get back with the 5th Armored, which I did. And back with the 5th Armored, and they were not too far away, I guess. And I know we went through Paris, not with any stay in Paris, but through Paris, and swung around and went north to protect some bridges on the Seine River that are north of Paris. And from there, we went across northern France and a little bit into Belgium to Luxembourg. And the Germans, in the meanwhile, of course, were retreating in High Gaul. This is much later, in September now of 1944. And the Germans are retreating back to the line that wasn't really manned, because after all, the German troops were few and far between, so to speak, after the butchery of them in Normandy and the Russian front. So we were the liberators, the 5th Armored Division of Luxembourg. There's a picture of General, I can't think of his name again, the commanding general. He had a funny name, and a good man too. Matter of fact, I went to his funeral up in up near Amherst, beyond Amherst, when he died. He was turned out to be a preacher ultimately. He was an old man, so to speak, from my vantage point. What was his name? Sorry.
Was that Alonso Ward?
Huh?
Was that the one named Alonso?
No. So that was...
You were in Luxembourg?
But that's not the end of my story. We moved into Germany, crossed the Rhine, and the British... pontoon bridge over the river, and moved down. The Germans, of course, were retreating, and finally the armistice came up, and we were billeted in... Oh, what's the great German state where Leipzig is? In any event, in the division that occurred, this part of Germany was to become Russian. And so many divisions, parts of them, were broken up and put in particular towns for billeting purposes and to greet the Russians when they came in. Well, we were in one town, I can't remember the name of it, and I have it at home. We were in a little villa, a big villa, that was owned evidently by a very wealthy German woman, English woman, who spent a lot of time in Germany and went home to England in the summer to tend to a garden, right? Well, she had long since gone to England with the breakout of war, and a captain in our outfit who had nothing to do, but he was given jobs of finding places for the troops to billet. Bueller, his name was, from St. Louis. He chose this place, a very beautiful place. And there were a number of people living in it. There was a lady with three little children. There was an old man. And there was a young man, and the young man was a very interesting one. Now, I didn't find out much about the young man until later. However, what Bueller did was give these people, and they're all Germans, and he hated Germans, he gave them a half an hour or an hour to take their belongings and move out of the building and go down to the lowest town and see the Burgomeister, who'd put them under arrest. They had no tools, no armaments. I came along having flown in with in a Piper Cub from the last place we were at with Woody, Major Woody Boatner, who was in charge of the Piper Cub. He's a good friend of mine. And I'm walking up this hill to this place, and I couldn't believe what the hell I was seeing. I was seeing a moving rug. A rug that was all rolled up and very thick, and three little kids running ahead, and a man, two men and a woman, trying to carry it down. It turned out that they were the occupants of the house. Boltner and I got some, he had a walkie-talkie, and he called up and had one of the little pickup trucks sent down to take the stuff and drive it into town for them and make sure they go under Burgermeister's strange head. All of them went. I didn't know one from the other. Okay. Next day, my sergeant, master sergeant, and I are trying out a couple of guns we discovered. I had a German Beretta and he had a Luger, I think, and we're going to try them out. So we get down to a little copse of woods, a couple, about three times as large as this area, and we're about to, you know, put some ammunition in the guns and fire them, when all of a sudden, on the ground there appeared well, we could see it by the way the leaves, almost in a circle, had been put together, right? And they were different from the other patterns of the leaves in this little forest. They looked rather suspicious. And the first thing that both of us thought of was that this could be a body of an American airman, because the Germans, towards the end of the war, with a very heavy bombing going on, were shooting down American flyers and British flyers who had parachuted out of there.
Yes.
And came down and shot them and buried them. So that's what we thought. Scraped around, it was a tin can. Didn't think much of it. We picked it up, it was sealed. Didn't open the seal. Took it in and I put it in my my little safe, since I was G2 at that time. The next day...
Would you explain G2, please? Is this intelligence?
Yeah.
Intelligence. All right, thank you.
I'm sorry. The next day, an English gentleman in a colonel's British outfit with epaulettes and everything else, with a hell of a Scots accent, comes up in his car, and with him he has this man whom I saw the day before with the lady
in the rug.
In the rug?
Yeah.
And he had another guy with him. His name was, he was fresh off the boat from Boston, or from America. He had just received his German PhD in literature, and he was sent along on the blacklist team, which was what these characters were called. It turns out that he was the understudy to Dr. Schmidt, Herr Schmidt, I think his name was, or was it Schack? No, it was Schmidt, who was the principal interpreter for Hitler in the Foreign Office. And this guy was his underling. He spoke English with a beautiful accent. I got all the papers at home on this. He spoke English with a beautiful accent. And I said, did you live in England or what? He said, no. I went to Oxford with Duncan Sands. Duncan Sands. Duncan Sands was Anthony Eden's son-in-law, right? Anthony Eden was the ministry of the Foreign Office in England. And I said, oh, and then my friend, oh, what a wonderful man, the colonel, I can't think of his name, and I had it written down here. He started to explain who he was. He said, I'm on the member of the blacklist team. We are from OI-5 or 1I-5 or 501 or something like this, which was intelligence in Britain. He said, we're here on a special mission because we heard through the underground that many of the German officers were moving their files out of Berlin, and they were burying them in out-of-the-way places. And he said, the team is a huge team. They were scattered all over the occupied territories, was to see what they could do to find this. Well, this man in a British uniform now, talking with a sick Scots accent, he turns out to be the archivist of the German Foreign Office Library, who spoke all the European languages. Oh, God, I'll never forget this.
Mickey. The war is over?
War is over, yeah.
And how, when did you get home? It seems to me they're keeping you there long after the war had ended.
Oh, no, I came home in September.
You did?
Yeah.
All right, would you tell us about your last days in Europe and coming home?
Last days in Europe were in one of, It wasn't Lucky Strike, and it wasn't 20 grand. I forget the name of the place where the troops who were going home from a particular unit would be collected in Belgium, all right? They were all in these 20 grand stands all over the place. They were like barracks. And then we were put on trains, if I'm not mistaken, and well, where the hell did we go? We went to one of the French ports, and I don't know which one it was.
But you came home by ship, is that it?
Yeah, came home by ship, and I forgot the name of the ship. I've got it written down somewhere.
And where did you land in the United States?
Land in New Jersey. And from New Jersey, went to, what's the big camp in New Jersey?
Kilmer?
Fort Dix.
Dix or Kilmer?
Fort Dix. No, it was Kilmer, you're right. That's where we disbanded
and, did
and
you,
said
did
our goodbyes, and then we were to report report to a particular office when we got home, and the one I had to report to, of course, was Fort Devens.
That's and where you started?
That's where I started.
A long time ago.
Oh, God, what a hegira.
You've told us today about extensive service in the United States.
Of varying kinds.
Yeah, and a good education through the Army, on top of your very academic, wonderful academic credentials. Is there one thing that, before we end here today, one outstanding experience or something that you'd like to leave with the people who are going to look at this tape a long time from now?
Yeah. It was the opening of that can I talked about in the library of that building I talked about. I got a picture of the building at home, too. When von Loesch cut the German plastic that was around, it was an old raincoat, and told us the story of what happened. He was sent with a guard of maybe a platoon, a reinforced platoon of SS troops from Berlin to this place that I'm talking about,
yes.
All right? To guard the can. The SS troops were to shoot on sight anyone who approached, right? They were told that the Germans were reviving a battle force in the Harz Mountains and that they were going to move out. And that was all baloney, of course. All right. I think it was the 9th Armored Division, if I remember rightly, that, well, what they did, they came in, it was 25 or 26 boxes. I've got one of those boxes at home that, I don't know how I got it, but I got it, small one. They're beautifully made, painted gray, locks on them and all that, I mean clasps on them. There were evidently, let's say, 25 of those, within which were the original documents of the history of the Foreign Office in World War II. You got me, all right? There was one box that contained the microfilms. And the Germans were way ahead in microfilm, evidently. But these were microfilms. Okay.
What was on these?
They were
films?
In a box.
Yes.
All broken up. I mean, not all broken up, but in sheets. And they were told that they would examine the sheets, the boxes, to make sure everything was there, and burn them if any reports came through that the enemy was approaching. And sure enough, it was the 9th Armored Division, evidently, I think it was the 9th, that was coming in by leaps and bounds into that area. This was now before the armistice. And that when they got that word, they were to take those boxes, examine the contents one by one, and throw them on a fire. What von Loesch had done, and that was his name, Karl von Loesch, he had, how he had did it, nobody knows to this day. He had taken that box and had taken the things out of it, the microfilms. He had cut them all up in strips and two flashes on each strip and mixed them all up and put them in this German GI can. You know what a GI can is?
Yes.
With its top you press on. And buried it. It was wrapped in a German army raincoat, which was the plastic, the English call them a Macintosh, I guess, and he buried it. By accident, the colonel I'm talking about was in, what the hell is the name of the town? It was about 20 miles away, filled with American troops. You know, the war was over, running about and so on. And here he is, a singular figure with his Scotch uniform on. And here is von Loesch.
We have just a few minutes left here.
Okay, the colonel is looking for someone who can give him information on the Foreign Office. Von Loesch is there looking for someone who is English and not Americans. He hated the American, and the two of them meet. Figure that one out.
That's another coincidence.
And what were they? They couldn't be read by any of us, but von Loesch knew what was on them. And we went to a, there was no microfilm readers in any of the American camps, so we went to Camp Dentine, which was one of those British camps for taking the troops back. And it was an Air Force place. And they had a microfilm reader. My God. They're all in German, of course, and here's von Loesch interpreting them. The first one he pulled out was a strip, and there was about three things on them, I guess. And that strip was the conversation between the guy I talked about earlier, who was the translator. Not shocked. What?
For Hitler.
Schmidt.
Yes.
That was between Schmidt and Schmidt did the translating. It was between him and Goering or somebody else, and it was a request on Hitler's part to Frankel to permit the movement of German troops over the Pyrenees from France into Spain. In order to attack and destroy Gibraltar.
Oh, that's That's a wonderful story.
The third one he pulled out was a conversation between Baron Oshima, who was the Japanese ambassador at the time to Berlin, and Hitler. And what the hell was that?
Mickey,
that was a communication on the Japanese part to Hitler that what was cooking was the Great Battle of Midway, and the feints that they were going to make. They were hoping to capture Hawaii, but he didn't think that was going to be possible. But they were going to go into the Aleutian Islands.
Yes.
Hitler,
Mickey,
knew about that.
This is, you've ended on a very high point. We thank you very much for coming in today.
Thank you.
We very much appreciate your time.
Oh, I'm happy to do it.